the League of Women Voters of Central Nassau. And tonight we are co-sponsoring a panel. We're having a panel discussion about the alternatives to incarceration. Co-sponsoring with us are the NAACP Lakeview Branch, the NAACP Hempstead Branch. So I welcome all of you. So happy to see you. And we have a committee. Our committee program chair is Rachel Krinsky. Unfortunately, Rachel will be here in a few minutes. She'll be back. We also have as our moderator tonight, the president of the Lakeview branch of the NAACP, Mrs. B. Bailey. And also on the committee is Mrs. Elizabeth Boylan. We have B. Bailey as our moderator, and I would like to introduce you to her at this time.
Okay, first of all, I'd like to welcome you to the Lakeview Public Library. This place is special to me. I was a trustee here for 15 years, and we moved from the Tanglewood, small little Tanglewood building over here in 2002, so I always like to do programs here. It's home for me. This, for those of you who don't know, this was the colored school in Lakeview before desegregation, so it holds a very special place in history. I'm also a member of the League of Women Voters and NAACP, so I'm in the low piece of each of the sponsors here tonight. We have with us three great panelists. I'm going to start to my right with Miss Tisa Fitzgerald, and she is a sister of St. Joseph, founder and executive director of Our Children. And I'll let each one of them elaborate more on their bios, their histories, so to make it a little bit easier. Next to her, we have Assistant DA, Dana Boylan. And she comes with such enthusiasm. I just felt such compassion on the phone speaking to her. So I'm just overjoyed that she's here, that she agreed to do this. And she is the Director of Community Reentry Initiatives and Youth Development Programming for Nassau County. And last but not least, I have one of my good friends, Alan Newton, who spent 22 years in prison before being freed by the Innocence Project. And he comes back into society and helps other people. His correct title is Research Associate for the Black Male Initiative at CUNY.
Good evening, everyone. I am Assistant DA Dana Boylan, and I do work for the Nassau County DA's office in the capacity of running our reentry initiative called CODA. It stands for Council of Thought and Action. I also work in the community affairs aspect of being the face that connects with our community on behalf of the DA's office, or one of the faces, and with respect to youth development. And I'll explain to you what each of those roles mean. But I've been with the DA's office for, this is my 12th year, and for the last 4 years I've been working with the reentry population, with our youth, and more connected to the community than I was prior to that. And I think this is an important panel discussion that we're having. It's very appropriate, it's very timely, it's necessary. For people to understand that we're no longer in an era where it's simply about arrest, prosecution, and incarceration. There has to be more. There has to be support, both for folks who are coming back to the community after being held accountable, and those who are in the system, who we can find room and it's necessary to divert them so that they don't return to the system. At CODA, we work a lot with individuals like the gentleman to my left who have done significant time behind bars. And what we found is, with support, many people do stay on track. They don't return to prison, and they do get chart new pathways. We meet men at CODA who've done 27 years, 25 years, men who've gone away from the time they were 14 years old and returned home as almost middle-aged men. And what we've seen is that it really is important to have those support systems. So I'm here to answer any questions that you might have with respect to alternatives that the DA's office has implemented over the years, what we hope to do going forward, and you know, why these initiatives are important.
Okay, so in the interest of time, and we want to be courteous to our panelists, Ms. Boylan has to leave, so if you have any questions for her specifically, they can be asked now at this time.
I have a question. How long has this program been in existence? And this is Nassau County?
Yes. So our CODA movement, which is what we like to call it, Council of Thought and Action, has been in existence since Congresswoman Rice became the DA. And so it's been 8 years. And over time, it has expanded. We're actually moving into Long Beach very soon, so we will have a satellite office in Long Beach to support that community. What we do is we try to connect individuals who are returning to the community with resources. And it could be as basic as having a support system where you can come to and voice your frustration rather than acting it out in the community. Or it could be as extensive as, I have a plan, I have something I want to move towards in my life, whether it's my education, a job, an internship, and we try to assist them in connecting them with those resources. Now, some people might ask, well, why is the DA's office involved with that? The first thing I think is important to note is that once a person has been held accountable for his crime, he deserves an opportunity to return to the community and be a full citizen. We do not have the right to continue to punish that person by way of not employing them, not housing them. We do not have that right. A jury of your peers has decided that your incarceration period should be 5 years. You spent 5 years in prison, and you should now be able to return and fully engage and reintegrate into the community and get all the services and support that the rest of us take for granted. So that's one philosophy. And the second thing is about community safety. When people return to the community, they generally return to the very same communities that they committed a crime against. And if we don't support them in their need to reenter and do it successfully, we are risking the possibility of them committing an act and returning back to the system again. So there is a community safety component. It's actually really, really important for you to support someone. Let's use the 14-year-old, for example. And this is a true story. Guy commits a crime at 14 and he gets 21 years. If you have a child who's close to that age or has ever had a child, you understand that he was a child. He commits a crime, he pays his debt for 21 years, he's returned to the community. Without an initiative like CODA or the Reentry Task Force, I see Victoria in the back of the room, without initiatives like that that supports his reentrance into the community, what are we working with? We're working with a man who went to prison as a boy, does not have the support systems behind bars for 21 years, let's not make any bones about it. The current state of our criminal justice system is such that you really don't get all the things that one should expect to get when you are supposed to be rehabilitated. And so you're returning this young man, now a grown man, to the community, doesn't know how to use a cell phone, doesn't know, completely institutionalized. His conduct is such that you almost have to reacclimate him in how to be amongst everyone, the rest of society. His education is bare, and if we simply say, report in because you're under supervision by, you know, the criminal justice system, make sure you get a job, you know, wherever you get a job, make sure you take care of what you have to take care of, stay in Nassau County, we're not doing our jobs. So an initiative like CODA ensures that he has a space to come to get all the questions that he needs answered. You have gentlemen that are there, like the man who's to my left, who have been through the system, who returned home, who's reintegrated successfully, and they serve as sort of mentors. Let me help you navigate. Let me help you figure out how to get back to school. Let me help you figure out how to get employment at my job, because I am, you know, I know that there's an opening there. We see it every day. And by the way, you're struggling with how to manage relationship with your landlord, with your employer. You've never been employed before. With people you interact with, let me show you how I navigate these systems. These are things we all take for granted. But these guys have, and women, have to be supported in this way.
Do you have a system, well, a way of letting these gentlemen and these ladies know about what you are doing? See, this is the first time I've ever heard of this. And I suspect there are those who don't know where to go to get help.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I just wonder, when they're discharged, are they told where to go for help?
You know, I mean, I don't know if they're told specifically about the Council of Thought and Action. I imagine that they're given access and information to resources.
Mm-hmm.
But what I will say is that if you're here in Nassau County and you have a relative or friend, someone you know that's returning to the community, by all means, have them contact the DA's office and get information about our initiative. It's real, it exists. We're in Hempstead. We're going to be in Long Beach in short order. We have a Facebook presence, and I certainly have give you my card. My phone is always on, it's always available. And you know, the office is very responsive. So yes, more needs to be done to market it and to make sure people are aware of it. And what I've spoken to you about is just the tip of the iceberg. So when we talk about the meat of why we're here, alternatives to incarceration, one particular aspect of CODA that is probably, you know, not widely known is that CODA is more prevention and intervention. You're already out of the system, either you're returning home or you're at risk, and we try to support you, get to ensure that you don't return or you never get there. The reality is that, what about the people who are currently in the system? So you have young people who have committed crimes, they're in the midst of being in the system, they're going through the process of being prosecuted. And every now and then we come across someone and we say to ourselves, as prosecutors, should this person be behind bars? For what we have here, for what we understand about their background, for what we understand as to what led them here. Let's say it's an addiction or a mental health issue. What else can we do with this individual? And so since I've been at CODA, what we've tried to do is expand upon the small group of people that we give CODA pleas to. And I'm actually quite proud of it. Yes, we need to talk about it more, but I'll tell you just a little bit about what that means. In terms of alternatives to incarceration, it allows for that one person, and I will confess it's not a large group of people, to take a plea where, let's say you could have taken the plea and gone away for 5 years, and the office may say, this is someone that we want to divert. We want to give you an alternative to that 5 years. We would ask that person to take a plea, and the agreement is, John Brown, you'll take a plea to an e-felony and an A misdemeanor. And if you do some things, and they're very tangible, real things, get a job, go to school, return to the community and help rebuild by doing community service. Get your chemical dependency issues addressed. Get your mental health issues addressed. And if you and attend our meetings, because if anyone knows, it's really the you need that support. All of those things that we're talking about can't happen successfully without real support behind you. So you attend our meetings, get that informal mentoring that's needed. And if you're successful over a two-year period, it's a long time. And if you show real commitment and you're successful over that period, at the end of the day, that felony that you pled to will go away. You will not go to prison, and you will be left with whatever you agreed with. Let's say it's the misdemeanor and probation or something like that. Why am I in particular proud of it? Because when I came to CODA, I think we had maybe three people that were doing it. Now that number is in the double digits. It's still low, but when I see a young man now at SUNY Old Westbury entering his fourth year of college instead of being behind bars, it moves me because that's what we've done. That's real alternative. Okay. When I see a young woman on my way here, a young woman who she's on the tail end of that two-year commitment, and she now has a job with a doctor's office. She's just gotten a second job, and she's taking care of all the things that she needs to take care of to make sure that she doesn't return to the system. That moves me. When we see young men who graduated out and moved on to other things and they haven't been rearrested again, that moves me. So to me, that's a real alternative to incarceration. Mm-hmm. Saying, we know we can incarcerate you for 5 years on this crime.
Okay,
however,
I know there are people who have questions.
I'm sorry.
However, I don't want to do too much. And we do have, thank you, Lord, for volunteers, a capable person in the audience who can answer the same questions as Dana when Dana has to leave. So I'm going to move on to the next panelist, and we could dial back the questions at the end,
yes,
if that's okay with everyone here. Is Alan Newton.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out. My name is Alan Newton, the research associate at CUNY's Black Male Initiative. I have some things to speak about also, and I'm glad Dana touched on some of the great points. I actually wanted to ask a question about, you know, some of the programs. You spoke about the college part and the mentoring part, things that we also do at CUNY's Black Male Initiative, which consists of four components. It has the education enhancement, it has the graduate pipeline programs, it has the GED studies, and we try to pipeline these students into the college, and we also have a reentry component. And our reentry component is definitely focused on college, because one of the things we understand, when these men and women return to society, and like Dana said, they return back to the same neighborhood, and they also return back to the same type of jobs they had before, unfortunately. And most of those jobs are dead-end jobs, which doesn't help them advance out of their community. It doesn't help them advance out of the predicament that they're in the first place. But let me give you a little background about myself. I graduated in 1979 from high school, was working for the New York Telephone Company as a customer service rep, and unfortunately, a woman was attacked in the Bronx. She was, you know, she was raped, robbed, and sodomized, and I was in Queens at the time with my fiance. And like I said, in 1979, I graduated and attended a party. A fight broke out, I got arrested. I got a misdemeanor assault charge, I got the fight. Now, 4 years later, I still got a photograph in the books. A woman is attacked in the Bronx. Even though I was in Queens with alibi witnesses at the time, I still got convicted of this crime. This woman was brutally raped twice. I was acquitted of one of the charges and found guilty of the rest of the charges. I was sentenced to 50 years in jail. I first put in for ABO type testing in 1986, 2 years after I was convicted. This is prior to DNA testing. So a judge granted me access to the evidence. Testing the evidence was sent to the medical examiner's office in the city. Now, they claimed there wasn't any evidence in there to test, even though the victim claimed that she was raped and, you know, she felt semen running down her leg. Subsequently, after I got exonerated in 2006, the scientist who was supposed to test this evidence testified that she was told not to test it. So basically, that motion was denied. 6 years later, New York State passed a DNA law. I was one of the first prisoners to put in for it. The law came out in August of 1994, and 2 months later, I had a pro se motion in the courts. And I actually started a new odyssey in regards to my criminal case, because what happened 6 years prior, they knew was evidence in there to be tested. It wasn't tested. So 6 years move along now, I put in for this DNA testing. And the thing about DNA, it's 100% guaranteed that either you committed the crime or you did not commit the crime. So the judge ordered testing.
I'm sorry. Now, you're making reference to the years and what took place.
Yes.
You worked your case.
Yes.
Explain that, please.
Well, basically, I was doing a lot of the pro se motions on my own, and as I said, 1994 rolled around, and I really had, I had a legal status to be able to file for testing now. Prior to that, you was basically asking the court to try to get ABO type testing. But with the DNA statute, I had a legal right now to get access to my evidence. Court granted access, and what happened, the evidence disappeared. Because in 1986, when that ABO type testing was supposed to be done, the medical examiner's office never returned the evidence to the Bronx. And I can actually say that was a mistake that actually that helped me. Because if the evidence had actually stayed in the Bronx, I would not have been exonerated today. I would have still been in jail, but it never got picked up by anybody in the Bronx. So what happened, they sent it to a warehouse in Queens called Pearson Place. And now every 2 years, I put in a new motion, get access to this DNA evidence. Every 2 years, the judge granted me access to the evidence. Every 2 years, the city of New York claimed they couldn't find evidence. It disappeared. The police department didn't know where it was. District attorney's office didn't know where it was. But the medical examiner's office knew where it was. I sent them a FOIA request, a Freedom of Information request. And what happened, they told me by law, they did not have to turn over the evidence to me. And they not only did not have to turn it over, but they did not have to tell me what they did with it. I filed motions in court, I got denied. I filed a motion in New York State Supreme Court. A judge told me I was not granted access to my own evidence in my case because it was a sexual assault. And any evidence that's revealed to me may reveal the name of a witness. Now, I went to trial, I had alibi witnesses testify in regards to where I was and everything. So every motion I put in got denied, basically, because the evidence could not be found. So eventually, my family and I got in contact with the Innocence Project, who was known for doing this type of work around the country. And one of the first things they told me, they said, Alan, you've been looking for your evidence for a long time. There's a possibility it doesn't exist anymore because, you know, I've learned now they had to close almost 30 cases where evidence just disappeared. And I basically told them, I don't have anything to lose. I mean, I know it sounds funny, but I was prepared to do the whole 50 years. I mean, because I went to the parole board 3 separate times. I lost both my parents while I was in there. And one time I said to my family, I might have to change my strategy to try coming home. And they actually, you know, knew what I was talking about. I was actually thinking about admitting guilt, going to the parole board and saying I did it, even though I went there 3 separate times, telling them I didn't commit this crime. But I was in a catch-22 situation because I refused to take any type of programming, you know, that addressed my conviction. The parole board could not release me. So I was not going to go to them anymore. And, you know, 3 times I got denied. But, you know, God willing, the 4th time, when it was coming up in 2006, I had already got exonerated. But what happened, the Innocence Project got in contact. They filed a motion, and they found evidence. They got in contact with the district attorney's office, and this was the funny part. District attorney's office actually wrote a letter to the police department, you know, directing them to try to locate this evidence. And in the letter, they said, let's locate this evidence and bring this man's case to a closure once and for all. They probably thought, okay, this guy is guilty. You know, he filed motions all the time. But one thing I was trying to, you know, reiterate when I filed these motions with the court, look, if I file this motion and I'm guilty, I can never file a motion anymore that the courts would ever respect in regards to my conviction. Because they're going to say, you have a DNA evidence here that's saying that you're guilty. And this was always my point. Now, I would have loved to get, you know, get out of jail on a technicality. You know, don't get me wrong. But I had a sexual assault. I got 5 sisters, 4 older sisters. I got 15 nieces now, right now. And, you know, yes, I would have, you know, would have liked to walk out the jail, but I would not have wanted to walk out with that over my head that I was convicted for a sexual assault that I didn't do. I mean, people said to me, well, why you ain't take a plea and try to fight it? You know, I said, if I had anything, if I had just a robbery, or maybe just assault, I would have accepted that 3-year plea that I was offered. They offered me 3 years, sir.
Could you share with the community what a bid is like for a person accused and guilty of a sexual assault in prison?
Well, I think it's different for everybody, though. Your case depends on whether your case got publicity.
You know,
and my case didn't get publicity, so I was just basically dealing with, you know, people asking me a robbery or assault, and it's different in there. I mean, you really have to stand up for yourself regardless of what crime you have, whether you committed or not, because you got people that's trying to judge you for something you did or not or didn't do, but you got guys that killed 5 and 10 people over the years. But they trying to judge you because you may have knocked somebody, bust somebody in the head. Now it's all wrong. So you have to stand up for yourself, you know, regardless dealing with anything. You know, whether it was your money, your life, you know, I mean, you had to stand up for yourself the same way you got to stand up for yourself out here. Now, what I learned to do, whether it's dealing with fellow prisoners and whether it was dealing with administration, I became a writ writer. I started working in the law library. You know, I got educated. I went to college while I was in there. You know, I started, you know, working around people that had, you know, positive, you know, things going on. I started playing chess and Scrabble, things that, you know, keep you isolated in a certain way, and you start looking, dealing with yourself. College was one of the best things to help me going back in there, and they actually have taken it out of there a lot now, and it helped me because when I initially signed up, it was because it was free, I must say. You know, it was getting a free education, even though I didn't know if I was coming home. But after a while, I realized, you know what, it kept me out of trouble, you know, and I saw how easily it was for people to get caught up, and unfortunately, and this is why when a lot of brothers and sisters come home, their mind is not right. Because you get caught up in a system, whether you're trying to protect yourself from another prisoner or the administration, you lose focus. My focus was, you know, not only trying to get educated, which was my second main point, but my first one was trying to prove my innocence. So I went in there with a mission, and I've seen people that go in there with missions sometimes say, look, I'm facing 20 years, I cop out to 5 years and try to come home to my family, and they get distracted. You got drugs, you got guns, I mean, you know, knives and weapons and so many things that go on in a penitentiary that could distract you. So this is why, like what Dana said, you know, you get around people that can really give you something that'll help you when you come home. You know, you can find mentors anywhere you go in life. Anywhere you go, and like I said, I work with the City University now, and we help this population when they come home. We try to find the mentors, but the biggest thing is trying to get educated and stay educated, because, you know, I speak to young people all the time now, and I tell them how important it is for, you know, one of them in the group. You know, somebody need to get an education. Somebody need to get in medicine. Somebody need to get in law, and somebody need to get in finance, because it's like the building blocks, you know, to helping us in the society move forward. Instead of, you know, being reactionary, we need to become change agents and stakeholders and take charge of things. I mean, there's a judge called, what's his name? He just stepped down from the Supreme Court, Justice Milton Tingley. He just stepped down from the Supreme Court Justice in the Bronx and became the court clerk because, speaking with him, he said he needs more people to honor and to respect the jury notices when they go out, because we argue with the system, but when we get that jury notice as far as come sit on jury duty, oh no, I don't want to do this, I don't want to take my time, and you know, so this is what happens when we get somebody selling a vial of crack because they got a habit and they trying to make back their money. What they get when they get caught, they get 7 years in jail. They was giving brothers and men and women 7 years in jail for one vial of crack, because sometimes people on the jury is like, well, you know, my neighborhood is so ravished from drugs that instead of, you know, taking initiative and trying to do something that would help, a lot of times we just sit back and say, you know what, it's best, you know, that this person may go to jail, because we think, okay, if this person go to jail, things gonna change. No, it doesn't change for the better, because once, you know, unfortunately, law enforcement see that, you know, they can manipulate and I don't know what other words to use, manipulate, divide, and conquer, and this is what tears community apart. So I'm proud when I hear about, you know, programs like CODA that, you know, Alternative to Incarceration, that's trying to, you know, change the conversation when it comes to locking men and women up and keeping them locked up for a long time.
Mr. Newton.
So basically, you know, in my experience, education, inside and outside, basically, you know, changes the conversation when it comes to, you know, keeping men and women from re-entering back into the prison system. You get educated, your mindset is different. Your thought process is different. Your ways of trying to hustle, make money is different, because now you're trying to get a license. And, you know, I mean, I know a brother. He's been home 12 years now, you know. He's selling, you know, $1 million real estate properties, you know, in gentrified Harlem. You know, he's been home 12 years. He did like 20 years. And when he came home, he said, you know, he had to, you know, do things different for himself and his young children. So in my experience, getting this population more educated is the biggest thing in my mind to keeping them from going back to prison.
Thank you.
I would agree.
Amen.
Yes.
I have a question to ask. At the beginning, you said that you were at a party and you got into some difficulty at the party, I think you said, didn't you?
Yes.
And I was wondering, probably at the party you might have been doing some drinking. And did anyone advise you that when you get drunk that you might act foolish?
That's what happened when you're 17, 18 years old.
Did I think it was
less, I think it had less to do with the drinking and more with my age. I graduated that summer in 1979. I was out partying. It was at a PAL party. So it was a bunch of young, you know, men and women. It was a big party, and it was less. I understand your point.
When I started drinking, 18 was the drinking age.
I understand your point, though.
Nobody bothered ever telling me, you know, Edward, when you drink that whiskey, you have a tendency to act stupid. And this happens a lot of times. Nobody tells these youngsters that when they drink, they act stupid and will get into trouble.
I think it's less to do with drinking and drugs now, more to do with peer pressure. There's so much pressure on these young people now. And because I tell them, you can't straddle the fence, because if you're a young man that's trying to go to school and stay on the right path, and you start hanging out with them brothers that run the street, they have this thing called, you have to put work in. So, and they know you an innocent brother. You know, you just trying to be out the music or whatever. They'd be like, you got to put work in. This is why you have so much innocent shootings going on. They have these young men out here, put a gun in their hand and go do something, whether it's shoot somebody, go rob a store. So that's why I say it's peer pressure. They're around. You can't, you know, lions, sheep can't run with lions, basically. And this is what gets them in trouble more so than the alcohol and drugs, unfortunately. But you got a great point when you bring that up, though.
Well, it takes a lot of peer pressure off.
We'll get back to the questions. We want to get to our third panelist, Tisa Fitzgerald, from Our Children.
Good. I have to stand up because I'm a former teacher and I'm not used to talking sitting down. I'm very happy to be here and have the invitation. I've come back to my roots. I grew up in the Five Towns. I went to school in Hempstead, and so Nassau County is really my home, even though I fled to Queens and I've been a convert there ever since. Just to give you a quick overview, when I saw the topic, alternates to incarceration, what I do in the work of Our Children is after the fact. And I think that was brought up by both the DA, Dana DA, and Alan. But I also have to say, I think right now we owe that young man a huge round of applause, but he is amazing. I'm really humbled by your story, and sadly I hear it over and over again. Just a quick frame, 30 years ago, I entered the world of prison up at Bedford Hills Correctional, which was a tiny little place at the time, 30 years ago, before the huge drug explosion. I went inside to work with one of our sisters who was doing a family service program inside Bedford. And when I met the women inside, I was hooked. I met their children. And again, I represent the female part of this, the woman's side. And too often when I go to conferences, the women aren't mentioned because people will say, oh, because their numbers are small. One person is important. And today in New York State prisons, we have close to 3,000 people, women behind bars, not to mention the thousands across the country in jails and in the federal system. So the issue of women is crucial to my life. I immediately took a U-turn in my career as a teacher, as a principal, and I entered the world of incarceration. We opened a home for children whose mothers were at Bedford Hills, and we called it my mother's house, so that the kids would say, I'm living with a friend of my mother in my mother's house. I was a licensed foster mother. I learned so much about the life of children whose lives were totally, totally thrown up in the air. And they always quote them the innocent victims of the criminal justice system. You bet they are, and they were then, they are now. So you look at alternatives, you have to look at family. And you have to, and I beg, look at the issue of women. If they're the caregivers, and most often they are, of children, look for alternatives that would say, instead of going into prison on a drug charge, look for some other way, a house. And I'll talk about, that's the model that we use right now. But it's post-prison. But it could be pre-prison very easily. We're looking at that now with Rikers Island, a diversion project that would take a woman back who is facing maybe 2 years, 3 years, no matter what it is, it's too many years in terms of her children and her life, offer her the opportunity to come together outside of where she was, that community. And my houses right now are in Queens, but we service women from all over New York State prisons. And I'll tell you, the common area where many people come, and I could tell you, I don't have to look at statistics, Roosevelt and Hempstead, right now in Nassau County. And ask me in Suffolk, I'll tell you right where they are, the Wyandanch and the Mastic Beaches. All you have to do, because I meet them. So let's fast forward, and I could go on forever, and I see all your signs there. From that point in time, in 1995, I realized I love kids, and I'm committed to kids, especially children of formerly of incarcerated mothers and fathers. But I knew that for kids to have a life, they needed to have stability and a permanency plan. So in 1995, I opened a house called, and we have Our Children, H-O-U-R, was the name of the charity that still exists today. And Our Children opened a home so that when mothers come out of prison, they had a place to go. It's wonderful to, if you can go back to your aunt and your uncle and all that. So many people, number one, don't have a good place to go home to, and they shouldn't go home where they were, because it's same old sometimes. They've changed, but nobody in their neighborhood knows, and the pressure is too much. So we opened one house in Long Island City. Today, in 2015, we have 5 communal homes for women, and I have 3 apartment houses. We have 70, 75 families who live together in community. I have a mother coming out of the Bedford Hills nursery tomorrow with a baby. She's from the Albany area and didn't have an option to go home to, so she's coming to us. And that happens very frequently. The nice part about Our Children now, actually nice, is because we now have the Department of Correction Services that were inside Bedford Hills and were inside Taconic Correctional, which is a medium security prison. Both are nestled away in gorgeous, rich Westchester County, across the street from each other. Across the street from each other. And then the only other woman's prison is up in Albion near Buffalo. So you have the triangle. But you try, when women go in, they go in through Bedford, and that's where they're, classified. Most of them are shipped away to Albion, 10 hours away from their kids in the city. Never mind add Nassau County and Suffolk County on. So what we're doing to families is horrific, horrific. So what we try to do inside Bedford and Taconic is we have transportation programs, we have advocacy programs, we have parenting programs. We try to do, but it's a make, it's not, it's what we do it well, but I wish we weren't doing it. I mean, because most of the women you meet in there, you listen to their stories, you say, oh my God, you shouldn't be in here. So we do that, and you'll see, I did bring a quick video, because I wanted to take you to Queens fast by what we do inside, but this is what we do outside in the community. And alternatives, you need a community of support. It's nice to say go back to mom. Some of my mothers go home. They're sleeping on a couch. After the first 2 weeks, you know, everybody's saying, when are you going to get a job? When are you going to get a job? Who's going to pay for the diapers? You know, who's going to buy the clothes? Who's going to make you look good to go out to get a job? There are so many issues that people have to deal with. In Nassau County in Suffolk, try getting to a parole officer and keeping a job. It's almost impossible. Mm-hmm. Takes you 2 hours sometimes to get where you got to go. And meanwhile, you still get a the parole officer says, how come you don't have a job? And then the other issue, this is another topic, lots of topics you have more talks about, job discrimination. Again, it's out there, it's rampant. I don't care what laws say, it's rampant. And the other issue is parole, and Alan mentioned it. Look at the parole system in New York State today. Look at it. They tried again and again and again for something they were sentenced for 20 years ago. The other day in Taconic, I met 10 women. We interviewed them for housing. Three of the 10 women were arrested at age 16, three of them, and they've served more than 20 years. And they're coming to me saying, sister, I don't even know what the world is like out there. And I'm desperate. I have no family. Where am I going to go? And if you don't have a home to go to, that's pretty desperate. And the recidivism rate is horrific. I don't know what it is in Nassau County, but statewide, 35, 40%. That's an awful number. That's an awful number. The people who come, women who come to our children because of the support system, our recidivism rate is 3%. And most often that's because they got fearful when they relapsed. And instead of trusting us to walk them to parole, say, we're going to get a program, they ran. But support, the network of support, whether it's through this wonderful program that's now in Nassau County or whatever's going on out here, they need a home. And I'm saying that again. If you don't, just think, if you didn't have a home to go home to tonight. The shelter system, and I was talking a lot, you know, about what the shelter system is offering out here in Nassau. It's very different from the city. Picture going into the Armory on Bedford Avenue in Brooklyn, where you're sleeping 200 strong in bed. You roll over and you're looking at somebody. All your earthly possessions are in a little locker. That's going to get you a job and get you a future. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. And there's a sense of hopelessness that you taste. You taste it when you walk into prison. So when we go in and what we try to do, and what we do it well, but it's too small. What we do is too small. And our model could and should be replicated all over the state. And then we'll try the nation. But it really could be replicated here. We have an initiative out in Suffolk County right now called New Hour, and they're an affiliate of ours. We're working in the Riverhead Jail, and we are providing services out through the Brentwood area to people coming home to Suffolk County, so at least they have something to plug into right away. Okay, you have the CODA here, they have that out there. But the big thing they need now is looking for a house so that people can have a place called home. So with that said, and I hope you have a lot of questions, I would like to, and I have a minute, can I show this little video?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
Is that all right, Greg? Yeah, we're getting a little round for my Just a little break. This just a quickie on this. 10 women from Barnard College, and Barnard is really a high-end women's college in Manhattan, really high-end. They were desperate for a place to do a video filming. The group that they were supposed to go called this the professor two nights before and said, I'm sorry, you can't come. The guy was out of his mind. What am I going to do with these people who are paying big bucks for this film course? So they came to our children. I went over to meet them, and I walked in. There were 10 of them around a table, and beautiful-looking, young, promising women. And I walk in with three of my women, and they were not happy. They were not happy. And they said, prison, incarceration, they were not happy because wherever they were going was really a little bit nicer topic, I guess. So anyway, we talked to them a while, and then they came over to our children in Long Island City where we are, and they spent 2 weeks with us. It changed their life because guess what? When they saw my women and they talked to them and they were good people. My women are good people. And that's what the stigma, the societal images, all the garbage that's on television about who ex-offenders are just went by the wayside. and they became mothers that were good mothers, that people with ambition. And this was the short video the women from Barnard created for us, highlighting three women, two from the city and one from Suffolk County. And I just think, again, it shows you, you'll pick up themes that we've mentioned here before, but alternatives to incarceration, it's all there when you listen to their stories. Okay, coulda, shoulda, woulda, right? Okay, action, let's take it away here.
Reunify with their families and build healthy, independent, and secure lives. Our Children provides compassionate and comprehensive services and encourages all to live and interact with dignity and respect.
I was born in Brooklyn, East New York, in Kings County Hospital, to my mother, a single parent who had bipolar disorder. You know, it was a rough childhood. My mother didn't have the tools to actually be a mom. At an early age, I realized that things just weren't quite right with my mom. I felt more at home out in the street than I did in my own house. And then when I was 19, that's when I got arrested for possession of a weapon, and I was sentenced to 3 years. I don't know why I was carrying the gun. That's what people were doing in East New York. I was about 2 months when I first got arrested, and like, well, I'm pregnant, what am I gonna do with this kid? But after speaking to the women, speaking to some of the officers, I realized that there was some hope for me and my baby. I was in labor for 24 hours, handcuffed to a bed. Even if I could have family with me, I had no one to call. You know, as soon as she came out, they put her on my breast. It's like you already felt all that love. Even though I never received it when I was like little, I knew, well, I was so anxious to give her all of this love that I had in me for her. You know, I did all that I could do in prison to make me a better person. I was taking parenting, I was in college, got my GED. So I reached out to the nursery manager and she told me about Our Children, and then Sister Tisa came. She spoke with me, she says, don't worry about it, it's gonna be fine. They really were concerned about keeping us together and letting her know that I was her mom. Michelle, she's 8, she's a phenomenal kid. I think she's gonna be a journalist or something. You know, I read to her, she reads to me, and it's, you know, we have a wonderful relationship. In 2005, I was released. I came to Our Children, and I had approximately 2 or 3 months. And then I said, you know what? This is not for me. I'm leaving. I went back to my mother's house. I had all of these goals, all of these plans when I got released, and I completed absolutely none. I reached back out to Our Children and I said, you know, Sister Tisa, can I participate in the Working Women program? I serve as an example in the program that it can be done. It's not over because you've been to prison, you have a felony. Your life is just beginning when you realize that you want to take control of it and do what you can with it.
Addicted to methadone. My mother was a drug addict. My father was a drug addict. I was born and raised around drug addicts. I went from taking like a couple pills a day to taking probably about 60 pills a day, easy. I now was starting to be arrested. And it's kind of like you get arrested once and then you're getting arrested every other week. And I literally was getting arrested every other week. I got pregnant by a drug dealer. I was 7 months pregnant. I was still getting high. You know, it was almost like I didn't believe I was pregnant, or I didn't even know what the right answer was. I turned myself in on a warrant. I was pregnant, shackled, in a big orange jumpsuit that no sense to me. These are Rikers Island. And I wound up giving birth to my daughter while I was still incarcerated on Rikers Island. It was lonely, and the only people I had there were the COs that were watching me. And it was just like, I knew at that moment that I owed this baby everything. Every bit of life in me, I owed Papa. While I was on Rikers Island, I met an advocate from Our Children, along with a mother from Our Children. It was, you know, the way she spoke about the program that made me say, okay, this might work. The woman had said to me, I'll see you as soon as you get to Our Children. And I was like, yeah, right, I'll probably never hear from these people again. You know, I guess I'm going back to Staten Island where I have nothing. I was literally going back to the projects, to the same apartment that I was getting high in and bringing my baby there. That was what I thought was gonna happen. And 2 days before my release date, here was the advocate like, oh, Sister Scott, I love you. And I was like, how are you? You didn't forget about me?
I walked through the doors and I knew that this was where I was meant to be. I knew for the first time, probably since my mom died, that I was going to be okay. It's not like I can call my mom, like, can you watch Savannah tonight? I don't have that. My entire family don't live here. So I don't have family members to turn to. So it's the women that live here that are my family. And they're the ones that I'm going to turn to. She's got a love for us that shadows our past. Our past has nothing to do with who we are today. She loves us for the person I am. I was given simple words, and those simple words made a light bulb off in my head. And if I can give that to just one person, I can't even explain what that feeling is. And I remember, like yesterday, this unbelievable crash, but I didn't know what I had hit. And I remember waking up and they said, man, you've been involved in a fatality. Nobody in a million years in Suffolk County, Long Island would think that Jody Kennedy could have relapsed. I had been in AA for almost 20 years, so if it can happen to me, it can happen to anybody. I had all the trappings of, you know, what America tells you is the thing to value, the house, the cars, the built-in pool. I spent my whole life trying to help people. That was my job. And here I had killed somebody. I was charged with vehicular manslaughter and sentenced to 4 to 12 years in prison. This organization is how I'm rebuilding my relationship with my children. Kids came to see everybody, but my kids wouldn't come. And I thought, maybe if I go there, they can help me start to see my kids again. I saw my son the first time in 5 years. And I don't even know what it was. It was, all I wanted was to rebuild my relationship with my kids. Sister Tisa believes that people can get a second chance. There's a lack of being judged for this horrific thing that I judge myself for, that I judge myself every day for. She says, hey, it's okay. We love you, and we're gonna show you how to love yourself again. And that's probably the heart of it. You're worth it.
People often say our children is about second chances. I really believe our children is about first chances. Our children offers women their first chance at rebuilding a life that they often dreamt about, read about, but never had the opportunity to create for themselves. So when they come to our children and they call us home, we, with many others, give them support systems and the love and the possibility to make that happen. They tell it best.
Okay, at this time we're gonna have questions, and this guy in the back has had his hand raised for the longest time. So, he's number one.
I've been a teacher for over 50 years. The last 17 years, I was a teacher at the Women's Opportunity Resource Center, which was an alternative to incarceration. Of the 50 years, that 17 years was the most satisfying years I had in education. Unfortunately, after 25 years in existence and serving over 1,000 women, the organization that provided the support, the EAC, which is the Educational Assistance Corporation, unfortunately could not fund it any further. And it decimated the program. This program got people, this gentleman mentioned, over 100 people from this program got the high school diploma. We had, when you go in for a diploma, for example, not everybody could read well. So it provided two teachers. One was a teacher who took somebody up to a certain grade, and then the other teacher would take them once they attained a certain grade and help them pass the high school equivalency exam. We had a computer lab where they were taught business skills. Somebody here mentioned about going and helping these women. We had a court liaison who literally went into the jail and interviewed prospective clients for the program. Rather than, as our motive is that we want to help people, but coming to the program is somewhat more difficult than somebody seeking out these people. And as I said before, I don't know how many of you are familiar with Johnson & Johnson. Well, Robert Wood Johnson, which comes from the money from the Johnson & Johnson family, actually awarded some money to the leader of this program, somebody which he used a portion for the program, Miss Diane Gaines, who would have been here, but she's away in California. Diane Gaines?
Yes.
Diane Gaines, who's in California now, her sister's grandson's getting married. And so she could have let the program go, but she did not let the program go. And she attempted to resurrect it. And for example, I don't know how many people here know of this. There's something called a certificate of relief from disability. This is some certain people who have committed crimes that are only a couple of moments, a couple crimes that are not serious, can be forgiven by the justice system. We brought that to them also. We won awards. There were literally people who won from our programs who became Students of the Year, and on the floor of the state senate, we had people who were awarded on the floor of the state senate. We had graduations where 200 people were attending. Thank goodness we're getting help from the district attorney's office, but their funds are limited. And perhaps I ought to conclude, I'm here for two purposes. The League of Women Voters, the NAACP, please, please, please exert pressure. And perhaps the best proof of how successful this program is, there's a lady in the back sitting. Can I use your name?
Sure.
Vicki Roberts.
Yes. Hi.
Who is the program coordinator for the Nassau County Reentry Task Force.
And they did do excellent work with young women, but funding is a problem. How do we go about getting funding? Aren't there grants to be written, or the county, or how do we advocate for greater funding so that we can expand these programs?
There's a way. There's a lot of different organizations that actually give out, you know, grant money. So whether it's a corporation, whether it's a nonprofit, a lot of times it's just doing research and submitting proposals to them, and just trying to get access to the funding, because like with students, same thing with scholarships. We tell them when you don't put in for that, those scholarships, they just get recycled. The money just go back, you know, for the next year. So it's just a matter of just researching the grants that's out there and just submitting proposals, because people are trying to give away money. And a lot of times, nobody's asking for it. So we just have to research the grant money and just try to utilize it, get access to it.
There is a lot of money available. The dilemma is that a lot of people do not know the process of applying for grants. They do not have the manpower or the staff to actually apply for these grants. So a lot of the money does go by the wayside. And as far as scholarships are concerned, you're absolutely right. Schools have a discretionary fund. If the scholarships aren't given to anyone, that money goes back into the discretionary fund. And like I tell all of the people that I work with, the population that I work with, if you're planning on going back to school, apply for the in-school scholarships. And my story is this. I applied for a scholarship that I did not qualify for, but I got the scholarship because I was the only one that applied for it. So the money is there. You have to do the work to get it.
The attorney's office is sort of in a unique position because it's the DA's office and it's government. But to answer the question with respect to funding, our initiatives are actually in large part funded through asset forfeiture. What that basically means, and I think it's important that the community knows this, is, and hypothetically speaking, a person is arrested and their property is seized as proceeds of a crime. So let's say it's a house or a car or something like that. When whatever that those proceeds are, they're liquidated or valued at, that becomes asset forfeiture. And the DA's office has made it so that some of our initiatives, if not most of them, that are in this space of reentry work and community development and youth development, that those assets that have been seized return back to the community through some of these programs. So CODA, for instance, is funded in large part through asset forfeiture. So someone commits a crime against the community, their assets are seized, and it's cycled back to the community, not all of it, because the federal government controls how funds are dispersed. But to the extent that the DA's office gets back some funding, it is cycled back to the community through youth development programs, summer programs, prevention programs, intervention programs, the work program, CODA, and I think it's something that it's a great thing. It's a great way to support the community and show that we're trying to develop the community as we go. We do apply for some grants, but for the most part, our initiatives are funded through asset forfeiture.
In asset seizure, are the assets seized before they're convicted or after?
I cannot comment on that. It is a great question. MySpace is alternatives to incarceration. I don't know what the process is, but what I do know is that I think your assets cannot be taken from you without due process.
So well, they might seize your car before you're convicted.
If you are, and I think we're going off track, but if you are in a, let's say you're in a vehicular crime, your car can be seized at the point of arrest. It is not completely taken over until some determination has been made that you're guilty. So you've pled guilty, you've been found guilty by a jury, and that is a point where it certainly could become county property.
What are you supposed to program?
Now, there was a time in my life I was a licensed broker, and I transacted real estate for 32 years as a broker in New York, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania. Upon the conviction of a felony at the age of 49, I went to prison. Mm-hmm. Now, while I was in prison, a partner who had been in there for 22 and a half years, we started a program called Disabled Educational Assistance and Reentry Program. I came home. The second chance that I was able to educate myself. Right now, I'm working on my MA in Community and Economic Development. Now, our program, since I was in housing, I was trying to get funding for housing. Now, in terms of grants, in which everybody is talking about that you can get them, trust me, I have a list of grants. I went through different foundations, and I have yet to be funded. My question to you
is how are you funded? You don't have to tell me about the personal, the private foundations or benefactors, but I would like to know what public grants can you apply for, because your program, I was talking with some people and we would like to replicate it on Long Island.
Yeah, good, great. I don't get any federal or city money for my housing because there's an issue now with the people coming out of prison are not considered homeless. The HUD definition of homelessness has really gone off the charts, so that they could look at you coming out of prison that you were cared for by the government and you had a place to live and a roof over your head, so you're not homeless. To be declared homeless, you have to go in through the shelter system and then be declared homeless in the shelter system, which I don't agree with. So we don't take any money from the city because I don't want to become a shelter. So, but that's one way of doing it, that you could be, if you could be a DHS designated place for people coming out of prison, that might work and there's money there. But we started independently, and to date, 30 years later, we're still independent. And it really is people's goodwill that supports us and programs. We have 3 thrift shops and some program revenue from our daycare. You need different funds of streams
of funding.
Definitely. Because if you count on one, you're finished.
Private foundations?
I get that, yes, we do. Okay. Yeah. But a lot of hard work and fundraising and all the things that you do to make charities work.
Okay, Ms. Lee, yes.
Okay, yes, hi. I just wanted to recognize that when someone is incarcerated, they're leaving behind a family. And these are the victims of crime that no one addresses and no one thinks about. That when a person is arrested and the children, you would know better than I as to how many children have a parent incarcerated. Oh. And they're the innocent victims of crime.
Too many.
We just put out a book called All I Ever Wanted, and it was written by the children of the incarcerated. And I have my flyers there. My program is Prison Families Anonymous. We work with the families of people who are incarcerated as well as the person when they come out of prison because they're all part of the family. And many people don't, we're just not considered when we think of the criminal justice system. When you arrest somebody, you're arresting a family. And we do our time on the outside. And I just like to bring that up as something to consider when we talk about mass incarceration. There are many more people affected than just those who are incarcerated. And every issue that has to deal with criminal justice, our families are affected by, including the innocents we have. They just went to get Jeffrey Duskovic the other day, didn't show up. But I brought with me a mom whose son is incarcerated falsely. So the families have to be an integral part of this, and we have to think of it as we consider incarceration.
But that's a great point, because they just had a New York Times article in regards to that, and how the federal government for years was picking and choosing what businesses they wanted to prosecute because they had to consider the shareholders and other factors of the companies. So because of that article, you had other journalists was talking about it. Well, we are considering, the shareholders and other financial factors, like these banks are too big to fail when they're prosecuting businesses. That same consideration should be extended to families because you actually are affecting people, children and, every other person that's related to that defendant.
I just want to add a little something and say something about the DA's office and the work program. As Maury mentioned, I am a graduate of the work program. I graduated from the work program in 1997. And fast forward to now, I'm the board director of the new women's work program. Right now, I am a consumer who has been placed on the board to address the concerns of the consumers. And I'm able to do that because of the two grants that were given to the work program because of the work that we do. Everyone in here there was a lot of information mentioned today, but I just feel like I need to say what I have to say right now. Okay. As far as being in this room tonight, I'm in this room tonight because I was at a meeting at Parole when someone mentioned it to me. And I have this feeling that I'm right where I'm supposed to be right now, because I'm a person who has had some struggles, whose children have had some struggles. As a matter of fact, my high school teacher is right there, so she can tell me. I interviewed for our children. I went to the work program when Mr. Morey was there. I managed a law firm that I've had contact with a lot of women in this room.
Where's Boyd?
I had the opportunity to change my life because of a program that said, you know what, you are somebody, you made a mistake, so let's do something different. So with me changing my life, my children's lives have changed. You know, my youngest son, who was born addicted, is now in grad school and a teacher. He actually taught at Juilliard this summer. My other son is employed. He got in some trouble and he came home and he said he didn't want to live this way anymore. I see what you're doing, Ma. I see the work that he did. He's been on the same job for 8 years. He's now a supervisor. So the struggle is real, but the solution is there. A lot of people hadn't heard about CODA. A lot of people hadn't heard about the work program. But, you know, again, I'm here to let you know that...
Good evening, Lakeview patrons. Be advised, the library will be closing at 8 p.m. The computers will be shutting down at 7:45 p.m. Please bring all items that you wish to take out or return to the circulation desk. Thank you and have a great night.
The struggle is real. The programs are out there. And I said earlier today that I found out about this meeting when I was at another meeting. And it's so funny because the meeting that I was at, I'm chairing a case conference at New York State Division of Parole. I am the reentry coordinator and I ensure services for people coming home following incarceration, and there are programs out there. We work really hard to help people stay home. The only thing that we ask you to do is just give us a call. If you have a loved one who's coming home and they're coming back to the Nassau County area and they're on parole, I have cards, just call me. I help with the DSS process. My office is actually in DSS, so I help with the DSS process. We set up job interviews. We work with CODA to set up internships, paid and unpaid. And I'm going to stop after this, but I just had a gentleman who just came home. He did an unpaid internship, and he enjoyed the internship, but he wanted to do something more hands-on. He applied to Sanitation District Number 2. They would not hire him because they said that he didn't have any experience, but we know it was because of the felony convictions. Mm-hmm. The internship that he did was in an attorney's office, and that attorney wrote a letter of recommendation for this young man, and he is now employed at the Sanitation District.
And thank all of the participants who came with their wealth of knowledge. There's nothing like knowledge. She has some announcements, and you have a question?
I'd also like to thank the committee. They did a wonderful job. Excellent job. I just wanted to make a point. The League of Women Voters of the state of New York, as well as the National League of Women Voters, they are at this time asking the questions about the youth, the 16-year-olds who are incarcerated, and I understand it's New York and another state, the only two states,
North Carolina,
that the 16-year-olds are incarcerated as adults. And this is something that they are taking upon themselves to speak to the politicians, and we're all working on that. I just wanted to make that as a point. But once again, I thank all of you for attending our meeting tonight. I think that we all learned something, had something positive about it, and I just want to let you know, please vote. If you have a friend that you can take when you vote, it is important to vote. And we're trying to have as many people vote in this, not only this election, and the election you have next year, of course, is the big presidential election, but the legislators are running this year, so please try to vote. You know, it's not a spectator sport. Yes?
Just mentioning along with that, on October 28th, at the Wiggleman Voters with Hofstra University Law School and Political Science Department, hiring a candidates forum for district attorney. I will be at the law school. So we'll have additional information, but please, it's an opportunity to, again, ask questions and learn about the candidates who are running for district attorney.
And I believe we, the Hempstead branch, I believe, is also having a forum October 26th at the Kennedy Park in Hempstead. And that is also for the district attorney. So we have quite a few things, and I hope that some of you will be able to make some of these meetings, some of these forums. And once again, I thank you for coming out.